Second part of our quantum quest. All aboard the Starship QI, we have, from a distant galaxy, Susan Calman. From another dimension, it's Joe Lycett. From a parallel universe, Holly Walsh. I don't know what planet he's from. Alien Davis. I'm just going to press the transporter thing again. That didn't quite work. I'll just do that. There we go. There he is, Alan Davis. Yeah. Their buzzers are highly illogical, Captain. Susan goes.
God, this is the sexiest night I've ever had in my life.
Joe goes.
Oh, yeah.
Holly goes.
Oh, yeah.
And Alan goes. Question one.
Captain's log, stardate 96778.53. Anything can happen in the next half hour. Our mission, should we choose to accept it, is to boldly go to a galaxy far, far away and become the first Earthlings to reach another star.
So, my question is, shall we get going?
Yes.
So here's the thing. If we are heading into interstellar space, it is not necessarily true that the earlier you set off, the earlier you will get there.
What?
Why is that the case?
Is it Southern Rail?
Is it because space-time is warps, basically? So the faster you go through space, then the time changes?
No. If you set off too early, the technology on Earth will advance while you have gone off, and you'll be overtaken by rivals who've left later but in a faster spaceship.
Oh.
They could pick you up, though, couldn't they?
They could, I suppose. That's the thing. Yeah.
It's like splitting tickets to get from Glasgow to London, because if you think, I'll go on the 7:30, but actually you're better to go on the 8 sometimes.
And leave it a bit later.
You don't have to change at Preston.
That's it, exactly. It's just like changing at Preston. It's exactly. So the furthest spacecraft from Earth is Voyager 1. It was launched in 1977. 40 years later, Stephen Hawking proposed an interstellar craft which would theoretically use energy from the sun to reach enormous speeds and overtake Voyager in just a few months. So the ideal point that we should set off can be found using a really simple calculation called the weight calculation. I'm sure we've all jotted this down at some point. So our recommendation is don't set off on an interstellar mission if it's going to take more than 50 years to get there. So currently, space probes can travel around 50,000 miles per hour. So it is definitely worth setting off to visit somewhere that is less than 20 billion miles away. But the closest star, so not our sun, to Earth, Proxima Centauri, is about 25 trillion miles away. So probably not worth setting off to at the moment.
There's going to be a cut-off point as well, because you basically want to put a 3-year-old in a rocket, don't you? You don't want to put a 50-year-old in a rocket, because they'll be dead before that even
gets... No, because you were going to stasis. You would do it like in Alien, they've got the tubes.
and you just you go to sleep in your pants because they're always in their pants.
Yeah.
I don't know why they never wore pajamas, but you're just
I
in
guess
their pants.
Because if you think about it, pajamas that your parents wear aren't pajamas you're gonna wear. You know, like fashion changes. You don't want to wake up.
What, timeless tartan pajamas?
Yes.
So. Tartan pajamas. So when I then wake up in 50 years when I'm at this star that you refer to,
you look like Rupert the Bear.
The first person to leave the solar system will almost certainly be a man called Clyde W. Tombaugh. He was the U.S. astronomer who discovered Pluto. He died in 1997, and his ashes were placed inside the New Horizon probe. That was launched in 2006. He's already had a flyby Pluto, which is great, because he discovered it. It happened in 2016, and his ashes are still travelling out towards the edge of the solar system.
That's sort of pollution, really, isn't it? Kind of littering.
You think so? Would you send your ashes up into space?
No.
Oh, I think it'd be marvellous.
No, I don't think you'd notice, Andy. I mean, I don't know what you expect to happen when you are ashes, but I expect you can see and hear almost nothing.
There's a company in America that now offers to turn your ashes into glassware.
Yours would just be a shot glass.
Wow.
I think you should be made into a monocle.
I think it would be great. Rather than sending your ashes into space, they should just propel your dead body so that anyone suddenly you're like, is that Sandy Toksvig floating past?
One of my friends had they had ashes of somebody turned into an egg timer.
That's a great idea.
I would have my ashes scattered in the petite section of Marks and Spencer's.
Anyway, old Clyde, who's up in space in this New Horizons probe, you can see it there, it's about the size of a grand piano. It's now in the Kuiper Belt, so it's in the outer reaches of the solar system. It's the furthest any spacecraft has gone. But basically, to get to the nearest star, it's going to take 72,000 years. So in space terms, despite the fact that they are all that distance from the Earth, 4 billion miles, it's effectively like we've just pulled the car out of the garage. Why is interstellar travel unlikely in the 21st century? What's the reason?
Well, is it because everyone would die before you'd get anywhere?
Yes, we'd never have the time. And also our best idea for rockets, which use nuclear fusion, would cause radiation enough to kill any human being.
The mutations might be quite interesting, though.
What mutations?
Well, if you take Spider-Man as an example. of a real thing that happened and was hushed up by the government.
Yes.
That was the effect of radiation. I was once bitten on the left breast by a guinea pig. And I wondered for some time afterwards, it wasn't an irradiated guinea pig, I'll grant you, whether or not I would acquire the powers of a guinea pig.
You'd be somehow reduced in capability. Here's guinea pig girl.
What is the particular guinea pig skill?
Well, they eat their own feces, is all I know.
But what you'd need immense speed in order to be able to get there. The real issue is we probably wouldn't be able to stop. So, because we'd be going so fast to Proxima Centauri, by the time we got there, there would not be the brakes in the world or in the universe that would slow us down.
But in The Martian, didn't he stop himself with a fire extinguisher?
Yeah. Anyway. Let's say we arrive on a new planet and find an alien. What should we do?
Kill it.
Well, that's what we do in the past and it's worked all right for us, isn't it?
The truth is that NASA does not have an official plan.
Oh.
The man who is the head of the Mars Exploration Project, a man called Michael Mayer, presumes that they would tell the president. No idea how that's gonna go.
Yeah, he's the person to tell. Stand in front of it and go boop boop boop.
But basically said it's a long time since they visited the procedure. But the truth is NASA doesn't have a great track record in terms of uncovering alien life. So, 1976, the Viking lander picked up soil from the dried lake bed of Mars and it roasted all the samples as part of the analysis process and it concluded there was no evidence of life. Curiosity, so that's 40 years later in 2006, did the same experiment without incinerating everything, and it did find organic compounds, so that's one of the first signs that scientists will look to for pointing to possible aliens.
Yeah, but I wouldn't roast it. That seems quite full-on to me.
Yeah.
I just sauté it a bit. There's a bit of olive oil.
There's another reason not to do that. Because we don't know its capabilities. If we've learned anything, anything from the history of documentaries about aliens, it's the common cold kills them.
Yes.
And that
or high-pitched noises.
High-pitched noises, that'll do it as well.
But also, if you know anything about any creature that you might find in the house, like, say, an ant, they're never alone. You can only see one, but there are others. And you find a mouse. They don't live on their own, mice.
Don't say that. We had one mouse in our house that didn't... Oh, come on. Oh, no, don't say that. No,
but a family, little family.
No.
Sandy, what did you do with the mouse?
I
killed it.
A trail of cheese. A trail of cheese out the back door. And it went, I think.
Yeah, went to get his friends and said, look, you've got to come to this cheese emporium.
Oh. Who believes that aliens have already visited Earth? Wow, straight up. OK. Anybody else believe it?
I think people who've been probed are correct.
Oh, well, if that's it, yes, definitely. Sorry, I didn't realise that.
The US government funded something called the Advanced Aviation Threat Identification Programme in 2002 to investigate reports of UFOs. It was a $22 million programme. It was closed down in 2007 because they ran out of money. So all we absolutely know for sure is that aliens did not visit between 2002 and 2007, provided, of course, the programme was working properly.
As far as they know, I never saw NASA in Glasgow checking for aliens.
Right.
So what if the aliens have just gone where they are not? So that's not empirical proof they haven't. It's just that they weren't there when the aliens were there because they couldn't be bothered to come to Glasgow.
Right, moving on. When Apollo 11 first landed, NASA was worried it might sink. What did they think the moon was made of?
Oh, jeezy peeps, just say it.
What?
I was actually going to say, do you remember the Christopher Biggins show on safari?
Yes.
And there was...
Such a niche reference. It's brilliant.
At the end game, there was quicksand.
Yes.
Did they think... Shut up, Jim. Did they think it was made out of quicksand?
They did think it was made out of quicksand. Oh. He's absolutely right. Well done.
It wasn't.
No, but they did think it would swallow the lunar module whole, and that is why they had those great, flat, broad feet on the lunar module, because they did not know what the surface was going to be like.
I thought it was just so the furniture wouldn't mark the carpet.
In the 1960s, one in every 35 films featured quicksand.
Oh, yeah.
Who was quicksand's agent? Because he was,
was doing well. So it comes from Middle English, it means living sand. Do you think it will kill you?
Is it actually
it
a
can.
Thing? Like, is it just...
Yes. Well, it quicksand is something you get in off the UK coast, isn't it? It can be really dangerous.
It's not going to kill you, is the thing.
Yeah, but it does kill you.
No. So... So you're going to love this, Alan. We wanted to show how this works.
We're going to kill Alan!
Oh,
it's
not a thing. Hang on a minute. All the people who didn't applaud.
The British Geological Survey, very kindly, have done a short film about Alan and myself at the beach and seeing what would happen if a quicksand developed. So here we are at the beach. And you can see the groundwater swelling up. And what happens is liquefaction. So all of the sand particles have drifted apart, making it a really mushy mixture. Basically, what happens is you get stuck in the quicksand.
Oh, I see.
That's not what kills you. What kills you is that you're stuck in the sand. Right. You haven't gone under, but the tide has come in. You haven't been able to get away. It's to do with viscosity and Newtonian properties. So what happens is it becomes so thick that it develops into non-Newtonian liquid. That means its thickness can change as you apply force to it. So quicksand is exactly like that. It is true that the more you struggle, the more difficult it is to get out, but your body is less dense than quicksand. You will just float. You're not going to be sucked under. And, frankly, most quicksand is only a few feet deep, so you and I might go. the rest of the panel will be absolutely fine.
So what, you're just supposed to lie down and sort of float?
The don't panic is the main thing. I love the internet because it has so many niche corners in it. Mm-hmm. There is an online community of quicksand enthusiasts. They're called sinkers. And they enjoy the sensation of, I suppose it's literally an immersive experience.
Mm. Is it like a fetish?
No, it's hard to say, because there are whole forums devoted to this. It's like the TripAdvisor of sinkholes, and they rate them for the quality, the depth, the thickness, the available parking. Here is the worrying bit. Privacy. Why would you need to be entirely private in
because
your...
Because it's a sexy thing.
Do you know what? I sort of get it, because I got for Christmas some of those jelly crystals that you put in. It makes the bath turn to sort of jelly, and I felt pretty saucy when I
Did that not feel weird, like your subcutaneous fat was kind of dripping out of you? And you were...
I didn't think that at all.
Yeah, I know what you mean. What's that thing where they suck out all your fat?
Yeah, it's liposuction.
And then you have a bath in it.
What is wrong with you?
I cannot have a bath, because if I try and lie down in the bath, I go like that and I drown.
I'll lend you our baby seat. It's really good. It's like you up there. This is one of the first arguments that I ever won, and I felt such a huge feeling. I was with a girl at school, and I said, I love baths. And she said, I don't like baths because obviously the water goes up your bum and then it flushes out all of the particles and you're basically bathing in your own feces. I only have showers, and I said, we must have absolutely loads of built-up feces in your bum. And I felt like, poof, I was like, it was honestly the first time that I'd ever felt like I'd won an argument.
There are creatures that actually sort of create their own quicksand in order to be able to hide. So an octopus underwater, if it wants to escape, one of the things it can do is make all the sand particles drift apart by making a sort of mushy mixture. So look at it, it's taking in water and putting it down to the sand and then it just disappears.
That's amazing.
So that's your quicksand. It's sandy, but it won't suck you under.
No, I will not take the bait.
Can I just say, can I have that as the special ringtone when you phone me?
So, they may not have any quicksand, but what should you watch out for when house hunting on the moon?
Foxtons.
What should you look out for?
I mean, I've looked at a few pictures of the moon. I think you'd want to find a house. Just one house.
Well, the difficulty about finding a house is finding a house that would stay standing up.
Oh, yeah.
What?
Because it's different, the gravity and all that, that's different and all that there, isn't it? But that's why the astronauts were all bouncy. It wasn't because of their shoes, it was because things are different up there, she said scientifically.
Yeah.
I'm not meaning to step on anyone's toes, but I am wearing the blue of the science officers of Star Trek. And there are nerds in the audience who are waiting for someone to acknowledge that.
OK, do you know what Holly is?
The red, of course, die first.
Go behind a rock, hear a bang, then you run round and there's just a pair of boots with smoke coming out.
Yeah. Because there was security and there was really no colour such as a teal uniform.
So I don't exist?
Yeah, you're the entertainment branch. Anyway,
is it windy on the moon?
No, so the answer is the same as earthquakes, but there are moon quakes. So the moon does not have tectonic plates such as we do on Earth. The quakes are caused by the strain of changes in temperature, also by meteorites hitting it or by tidal forces exerted by the Earth. Moon quakes are not just violent, they're really lengthy. So the initial quake is about 10 minutes and then it tails off, but it lasts for hours.
Wow.
And all the time, honestly, the moon is ringing like a bell. It happens about every month or so, and we know this from the seismographs left on the moon by the Apollo astronauts. In fact, it's disturbed the ground on the moon, and some of the footprints left on the moon by the Apollo astronauts may no longer be there. We definitely know that Neil Armstrong's very first footprint is not there anymore. Do we know why it's not there anymore?
Because they never went, did they? Is it because he was wearing stilettos and it just leaves a tiniest little imprint?
No, well, it is to do with another footprint. Buzz Aldrin stepped in it.
I always hated that guy.
And then, of course, the takeoff, the blast from the lunar module have obliterated it. What's the best place to live on the moon?
There's no caves or anything, are there?
It's really interesting that you mention that, because the Japanese space probe Selene recently found a huge cave on the moon. Yes, it is 31 miles long, 100 metres wide. It could contain a small city.
It's a 31 miles long and 100 metres wide?
Yeah.
Is it just one way in, one way out?
I don't think anybody's actually been in to find out if
there's an
exit.
There might be a bear in
back
there.
Door. Anyway, here is my next question. What can't I hear you do in space?
That's a very poor fitting out there. I'll never get my head in that thing.
It's fantastic.
You cannot hear sound in space. So when you see films, pew 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 pew, wrong, because you wouldn't hear the pew 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 because you couldn't hear any sound.
What is that?
That's a recreation of It's a space battle.
Space battle. Okay.
When I get excited about something, I pretend I've got like a missile launcher. I go. Do that in the car if you're in a traffic jam.
Just give me an answer. What's the answer?
Sound? Screaming sound?
So you can hear screaming then?
Well, it's a vacuum, right? Sound can't reverberate.
But there are conditions where you could hear a scream, and that is what I'm going to come to.
Yes, she got you there.
No, she has not got me there, because the question that was presented by my learned friend was, what can you hear in space? Answer, scream. And I said, because space is completely silent, which he said, and I went, did I just talk to myself?
No.
Because I just said that.
Because I did not say...
Oh, God, I wish I was in space!
I did not say what you might be wearing.
Oh, well, for the love of God, Sandy. This is like
and
the
this
worst...
picture was a clue. So, sound is caused by the vibration of molecules, and if you didn't have a spacesuit on, it would be almost impossible to hear anything at all. However, astronauts can talk to each other by touching helmets.
I'm off, all right, cheer up.
So the sound vibrations, they travel through the air inside the spacesuits and inside the glass, enough for them to be able to communicate with raised voices. Mm. And in fact, NASA teach this to the astronauts as a sort of backup in case radio communication fails.
Sure.
So we're going to try it.
Is that why you don't get any lesbians in space?
you've both got helmets, pop them on.
That smells really bad.
They're enormous, much bigger than mine.
Brian!
It's much bigger, but mine looks exactly like Caesar.
Stand up and touch helmets and see if it helps you to hear. Now talk to each other.
Hello.
I've always loved you.
Does it make a difference?
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Not really, Sandy, I'll be honest.
We can't hear you.
Can I take it off now?
No. Yeah, no, go ahead. Can you feel the vibrations through the helmet?
I don't think I could really hear, but I don't really understand her at the best of times, so...
No, that's just... the whole principle that vibrations travel through an object, it was a thing that Beethoven used later in life when he went deaf. He used to put a pencil in his mouth while he played, and he would touch the other end to the piano soundboard, and he could feel the vibration of the notes, even though he couldn't hear them. What would an astronaut do with a Snoopy cap?
I need to know this because my little boy's going as Snoopy for World Book Day.
Oh, OK, so that's the cap. That's Neil Armstrong wearing it. And it is the communication sort of radio-microphone combo, and they referred to it as the Snoopy cap. It does look a bit, doesn't it? It looks a little bit like
it
Snoopy.
It looks like when I put a bra on my head for fun on a Saturday night. Have you ever done that? That's exactly what I mean! If you've never walked into a room on a Saturday night with a bra on your head going you have not lived.
I have that to look forward to. Yeah. What would you do if you saw this chappie on the side of the road?
Hitchbot. So is it? Is it a hitcher?
It is, yes, yes.
Pick it up. You better pick it up.
You better pick it up. That is entirely correct. It is a hitch. Hiking robot. So, Hitchbots, it was a pair of robots. They were created in 2014 by David Harris-Smith of McMaster University and Frank Zeller of Ryerson University, and the aim was to see how far human kindness would take a mechanical hitchhiker. And the robots travelled through Canada, they travelled through Germany and the Netherlands, and they relied entirely on friendly human beings taking them from town to town. At one stage, in less than a month, one Hitchbot hitched a total of 19 rides, travelling more than 10,000 kilometres. And then they thought, we'll travel across the United States. 2015, in the city of brotherly love, Philadelphia, 17 days after they set off, the robot was found beaten up and dismembered in a ditch.
Does it have a message on it or something?
It has a voice box, and the robot would explain the particular destination that it wanted to go to, explain that it couldn't move of its own accord, and then it had solar panels which would help to charge it, and then there were cameras that took occasional photos, and then they were able to track them through the 3G and the GPS.
I love that somebody's idea when they picked that up was just kick the shit out.
Yeah. Do you know why I wouldn't pick that up, though? I have a real emotional problem with robots.
Why?
I fear the sentient nature of robots.
You're afraid of robots?
I love them, but I worry that they have feelings and we're ignoring them. But you do! I've just said I've got a problem. It's almost as if you're taunting me with my own phobia.
But what are the chances,
right? 3 more seconds and it'll be towering over you.
What's happening about robot-human relations? It might not all be bad. So they did a research in some Germans in 2018. And they asked 89 students to look after a really cute-looking robot called Now and answer some questions and so on. And later on, they were told to turn the robot off. And it was programmed to say, no, please do not switch me off. OK, listen to you. So a third of the humans took twice as long as normal to turn off the robots that were speaking compared to the
please.
Ones that
oh,
said...
Please, please do not turn me off.
I'll leave it.
There were 13 students who refused to turn it off at all. They just couldn't do it. Do you remember Marvin from Hitchhiker's Guide?
Yes.
OK.
Brain the size of a planet.
OK.
Opening door.
Marvin, the paranoid android. Marvin the Paranoid Android from Hitchhiker's Guide. Hello, Marvin, how are you?
I think you ought to know I'm feeling very depressed.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. So you're a hitchhiking robot. Any idea why someone might want to murder you?
I'm 50,000 times more intelligent than you, and even I don't know the answer. It gives me a headache just trying to think down to your level.
Wow, I'm getting an inkling about that murder thing. thank you very much for coming on the show.
You don't have to pretend to be interested in me, you know. I know perfectly well I'm only a menial robot.
Well, anyway, 42 points to Marvin. Let's give him a round of applause.
It'd be a nightmare getting on the tube with that.
Was there not that terrible moment when it was one of the camera things that went to a planet or the moon or somewhere like that, and the last message it sent was it's going very dark now?
And I was just like, oh, my, that's the worst thing I've ever heard.
I think it might be the Opportunity rover on Mars.
Yeah, and it sent a wee message saying, that's me away now, it's going dark. And I was like, oh, my God.
I don't think it said, that's me away now. before putting on tartan pyjamas. Well, what I can tell you is that Marvin was actually designed by somebody. It was designed by Dirk Maggs, producer of the last four series of Hitchhiker, operated by his son Tom. And Dirk has just flown in from New York, especially where the sixth series has just won a major award. Where are you, Dirk?
There. Yeah. Okay.
And in fact, our very own John Lloyd was the voice of the book. Fantastic. Thank you very much for joining us. Now, back to quests. What are these people firing at each other?
Choo, 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 choo.
Not lasers.
Not lasers, no.
Light-emitting diodes.
A torch.
I like the torch best. So they don't actually fire lasers, why not?
Because you'd die?
You would die, yes.
Which would be so fun.
Yeah. I guess, though, like, torch quest doesn't sound as good as laser quest.
No, it's not quite as exciting.
People aren't like, oh, God, I'll pay £16 to flash someone.
Yeah, no... they're firing infrared beams and they usually have a coloured light sent out at the same time, and I suppose it makes it look a little bit like a laser.
When I was about 12, my parents used to have a shop quite near a laser quest, so they'd basically just give us, like, the entrance fee and we'd just play for hours and hours. I used to sometimes just go on my own, and it was just... I mean, that's got to be one of the saddest things, you know?
Yeah, going to laser
being
quest by
13
yourself.
13 and just shooting at eight-year-olds, just, you know, like, knowing the terrain like the back of your hand. Yeah. Thinking, you idiot, you're going to get me here. I'm going behind the corrugated ramp. You're going to eat your dust, you dickhead.
So the difference is a laser is a way of focusing light in a single direction, so even a weak laser pointer can cause retinal damage, you know, if you expose your eye to it. The thing about laser beams is you can't see them side on at all, right?
Did you say lesbians or laser beams?
That's correct.
Quite a Freudian slip, that one.
Cannot see lesbians side on.
Let's try that out, right? I'll go here and see how many lesbians you can see on stage. I was here all the time.
Can't see a laser beam. Side on. Can't see it side on because the light is so concentrated, it's just going in one direction. Right. So in order to see it from the side, some of the light would have to be travelling towards your eye, and that happens if it goes through dust or fog because it scatters some of the light. Supplementary question, why might I say that Laser Quest is full of losers?
Holly?
Is it going to be an acronym?
It is. It is an acronym. You're absolutely right. Do you know what the acronym LASER, do you know what it stands for?
No, I have known in the past, but no. Okay, the first one's light.
Yeah, light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation is the thing. Oh. However, some people have noted that the light is technically being oscillated, so a more accurate name would be light oscillation by stimulated emission radiation. So, strictly speaking, a laser ought to be a loser.
Loser quest.
Yeah. And speaking of losing, set your phasers to buzz because it's time to journey into the uncharted quadrant of space that is general ignorance. Let's start with an easy one. What is this? Yes, Joe.
A melon.
Is it the moon or is it the earth?
I knew that.
You're not far off, actually. If we pull out, it is an artist's impression of what is a moon. OK, so this is a wonderful piece of science. So, in 2018, the astronomers Juna Kohlmeier and Sean Raymond, they published research based on one of the children's questions, Kohlmeier's children's, can a moon have a moon? Mm. So, it's a really interesting question. So, let us imagine that this is the Earth here, and let us imagine that this is the moon, and it's going round. So, the question was, can the moon have a moon of its own? So, here you'd have this going round the moon and the whole thing going all the way around the Earth like this. And they worked out it is mathematically...
Yeah, I'm going to say yes.
Yes, it is mathematically possible.
If it's got enough gravitational oomph.
Well, what they worked out is that the moon, OK, so the baby moon, the ping-pong ball, if you like...
another word for the moon.
I know.
I think it's technically called a tax haven.
This one, the moon's moon, would have to be no more than 6 miles in diameter. Any bigger than that, it would get pulled towards the planet due to gravity and it would be ripped apart. And the scientists have worked out that there are moons in our solar system, like Titan, which is a moon of Saturn, and Callisto, which is a moon of Jupiter, and they are big enough to host a moon.
Could you have a moon?
Well, yes.
Hey, what's the planning permission on moons? Yeah.
You know? I don't know. They have made another discovery that we, in fact, have something called the Kordylewski clouds, and Earth has actually got two extra moon-like dust clouds that orbit the planet. Okay. They're not solid, but they are huge. Each one covers an area of space 9 times wider than the Earth, and they glow very slightly in the light of the sun, but very faintly. It's very difficult to spot them against all the light of stars, the galaxy, the glow of the sky, and so on. Named after a Polish astronomer called Kordylewski. This is a very nice new football. Do you want it to take home?
Yeah.
Can I have the hockey ball?
Can I have the moon.
Can I have a present?
You can have the hockey ball. There you go. Give it to the kids, the one.
Oh, that's really sweet of you. Do you want the robot? Right. Name this phenomenon.
Northern Lights? Is it a shooting star?
It's not a shooting star.
Can I just say, I've watched this show loads, okay, and I've always hated that font.
Try it in another font next
if you
time.
Could, thank you.
So, what is the name of this? It is not the Northern Lights. It has a name, and the name is just an ordinary name. Just
Norman.
Steve.
Yes!
No.
It is called Steve!
What?
It was. So here's the story. It was first identified in 2017. It appears for up to an hour at a time. It was Citizens Science Skywatching Group, and they named it after the 2006 children's film called Over the Hedge. Yes. Do you know this film? Yeah. Well, the animal characters, not knowing what a hedge is and wanting it to be less frightened, named it Steve. So when they discovered this and they didn't know what it was, they decided to name it Steve. It can stretch for thousands of miles in a sort of beautiful purple band. Now, that NASA have got involved, they have officially said that STEVE stands for Strong Thermal Emission Velocity Enhancement.
Yeah. Forget going out into space and looking back at the Earth. I just had a very spiritual experience there.
Take the rest of the night off, mate.
Yeah.
The rest of the year off.
How many points do I get for that?
It's looking good. It's looking very good.
Oh, no, hang on. Just because he said STEVE.
Yeah. Yeah. You said Norman, which isn't even an interesting period for churches. Do you know what I mean? Steve. studies are ongoing. Nobody's quite sure what it is. Now, what's so dangerous about flying through an asteroid field?
Impact with an asteroid? There isn't a danger.
There isn't a danger. It's no more dangerous than flying through normal space. So we have to blame science fiction here.
Why?
Well, because it was portrayed as being unbelievably dense and treacherous, full of spinning rocks and debris.
Yes.
The truth is, the average distance between asteroids is about 600,000 miles. Most of the objects, when you do come across one, about the size of a tennis ball.
I don't think that's right. and again, I know you guys are all sitting there with your science and stuff like that, but, no.
Okay.
Were you there when the asteroids were made holding God's hand?
12 spacecraft have so far travelled through our solar system's asteroid belt. None of them has ever come even close to
colliding. But that's your issue right there, Sandy. What? Our solar system. I'm talking about the other solar systems that exist.
All the other ones all that we don't know about.
That we don't know about, okay, that might look like that.
I weirdly was sticking to facts we knew.
You should have QI brackets Earth version.
Yeah, that's it. The chances of being hit by an asteroid is about 1 in a billion. If you go into an
asteroid.
That
would be really unfair.
The chances of anything coming from Mars are 1,000,000 to 1. They say woo, wee, woo, wee.
And then they cut to the shot of the two of us with bras on our head.
That song from?
That's from Jeff Wayne's War of the Worlds. When I was younger, we only had one tape in the car for summer holidays, and it was that one tape, and we listened to it for 10 years.
That's a really long holiday.
We had the same with Joseph's Technicolor Dreamcoat.
Oh, yeah.
A flash of light, my golden coat flew out of sight. Colours will determine
I was left alone.
Was left alone.
May I return?
May I return
to the beginning?
The world and I.
The world and I.
We are still dreaming.
Contains a lot less material than you might think. Why is this skirt called?
That really was intolerable.
That was terrible. And you, all of you. Why is this skirt called a mini skirt?
Because of the size of it.
No, it is really extraordinary. It was named after the Mini Cooper, named after the car. So it had nothing to do with the size. So Mary Quant, she's the person who sort of popularised the miniskirt, she said it shared many of the qualities of the Mini Cooper. It was optimistic, exuberant, young and flirty, but she never, ever mentioned that it was small. Anyway, I had a thought, Joe, which is that picture that we had at the beginning with the woman wearing the miniskirt. I really liked the wig she was wearing, so I've got it for you because I thought it would look really nice in it.
Oh. Look,
yeah. Do you want to try it on, darling?
Just checking you haven't got the rest of the outfit.
No, I haven't.
Oh, Steve! You...
Oh, it looks really good on you, darling.
You actually look pretty hot.
I just look like an alien, don't you? Captain Kirk, I will destroy your ship.
Is that what I say?
Yeah.
Captain Kirk, I will destroy your ship, you naughty boy.
And so, before we terminate the show, it's time for Judgment Day. Let's take a look at the scores. First of all, in fifth place, light years behind the rest with minus 56, it's Alan. Receiving a special commendation from Starfleet with minus 3 in fourth place, it's Susan. Going down, all guns blazing in third, it's Joe. And in second place, lost in space, it's Holly. Tonight with 42, it's Marvin. So it's farewell from Susan, Joe, Holly, Alan, and me. Take us out, please, Mr. Davis.